Now to a true Aussie music success story. Air Supply have millions of fans around the world after writing and recording a string of hits that capture the essence of love. And for decades since they first stepped onto the stage, they're still entertaining fans. Russell Hitchcock and Graham Russell are Air Supply, and Angela Bishop recently caught up with them for this Australian TV exclusive. You know you can't fool me.
It's a Friday night in Los Angeles, and Air Supply is doing one last sound check for that night's show. The duo won't take the stage for another 4 hours, but that hasn't stopped these fans braving a rainy night to meet their idols.
Good show tonight.
Thank you.
Our fans are very loyal. They've been with us for a long time. A lot of them have seen hundreds and hundreds of shows. So they're kind of part of the family, you know. They just come to have a laugh and cry.
And crying?
Oh, well, they'll be crying in the audience.
How come?
Oh, no, that's Russell. No, they do. You know, well, the songs go back a long time and they become a soundscape to their lives. What's the buzz?
Tell me what's happening. It's been more than four decades since British-born Graham Russell met Russell Hitchcock on their first day of rehearsals for Jesus Christ Superstar.
We were both cast as apostles and vultures and lepers and merchants.
We were just thrown together and I started to play songs and Russell was right there and he'd just jump in and sing. And it just sounded so good, you know.
So when Jesus Christ Superstar finished, you guys already had a song ready to go, is that right? You were ready to hit the road as Air Supply.
Well, we didn't have a band. We had a couple of songs which we made a demo of, and we just took it around all the record companies, and they all said no. Love and other bruises makes us all good losers. It was a rock and roll climate, you know. AC/DC were right up there, the Angels, you know, and then
the Oils,
yeah. But every record company said no. They said you're crazy, you know, you can't come out with a ballad. Then, but one of them said yes, and CBS said yes. Peter Dawkins produced the track of LNOBs, as we call it.
LNOBs, is that Love and Other Bruises?
Yeah, yeah.
What do you call it? LNOBs.
LNOBs. Yeah.
It's like Eleanor Rigby, but it's LNOBs.
Love and Other Bruises was recorded in one afternoon and shot to number one on the national charts. That same year, they opened for a superstar.
We were only 6 months old when we opened for Rod Stewart, you know. And then suddenly we were in the United States opening for the biggest act in the world, and we had to learn quickly. But, you know, we became friends with his whole entourage.
I bet you saw some things.
We were in Lakeland in Florida. We stayed at this really funky hotel and we drove ourselves around in this station wagon then, you know, and one of Rod's guys threw a TV off the balcony and it landed through the windshield of our car.
Oh no.
Coincidentally, so we had to pay for that.
Yeah, you're not a big fan of the throwing TV.
No, we're not TV throwers.
On their return to Australia, Graham and Russell released their debut album, Life Support. Lost in Love became the fastest-selling single in the world. I'm all out of love. The follow-up, All Out of Love, went up the charts even faster. Right, believing
for so long. I'm thinking of the songs we've got, Love and Other Bruises, Lost in Love, I'm All Out of Love, Making Love Out of Nothing at All. Was that intentional or was it just what you were feeling?
It wasn't conscious at all, because we didn't know what we were doing, and that's a Russell quote. He said, we never made any mistakes. Because we didn't know what we were doing, and we really didn't, you know. No, I mean, I've been writing songs since I was 11 years old. You know, I'm that kind of person. I'm a very deep, emotional person, you know. But it was later on when I thought, God, I've got to stop using that four-letter word, you know. So I consciously made an effort after that to...
It seemed to be working pretty fine. I don't think it's...
Yeah, but it wasn't by design, it was by default.
Seven top five hits later, Air Supply equaled the Beatles' run of consecutive US top five singles.
So America's home now. Why did you decide to live in America?
They told us, the upper people at CBS said, you know, you should stay in Australia now because we can make you the biggest band in Australia. And we said, we don't want that. We want to be the biggest band in the world.
And I can make every time cool at the sound of the wind, so I can make all the stadiums
know, no disrespect to Australia, it's my country, I love it. I still have an Australian passport. But when business comes into the equation, you've got to make decisions that are difficult sometime.
Have you copped flak over the years?
Oh, are you kidding me? Of course we have, yeah.
We're the flak coppers. I mean, we're... From hell.
There's nothing you could say about us that would offend us anymore that hasn't been said by an Australian journalist ever. Yeah, we're soft, we're fairy floss, we're pansies, our music is not relevant. I mean, you name it. At this point in our career, we've got nothing to prove to anybody. You know, we've had success all over the world. We've sold 60, 80 million albums. We've had 7 or 8 top 10 hits in the US and worldwide. So get out of that. Girl, you're every
woman in the world to be. Did you have that feeling that sort of it was more than just chance
absolutely,
that put you
yeah.
together?
It was preconceived, there's no doubt, in the universe, whatever it is. After we met, we realised that we both have the same name.
Yeah.
We're born 3 days apart.
We both support and respect each other's talent, and we're the best of friends. We've been through hell and high water together, both professionally and personally. There's a great love and understanding of each other on a brotherly basis that I've not seen anybody else in the business in all my time have what we have together. And people say, why don't you fight? And we always say, if it ain't broke, you don't have to fix it, because we get along on every level amazingly. So you party all night, music and
lights, you don't know what happiness means. Air Supply performs more than 130 gigs every year. On this night, the fans at the Canyon Club are swaying and singing along to all their hits. Soon, it will be Australia's turn.
We'll always be an Australian band, and we're very proud to be so, you know, and we're very proud of our success, you know. So we're definitely looking forward to coming and to show people what we sound like 40 years later. I think we sound the best now than we've ever sounded.
To borrow a line from Barnaby Joyce, the crowd there went off like a frog in a sock. It was the Canyon Club, which is quite a classic venue just out of LA, Calabasas, in Kardashian country, if you like, where the Kardashians live. And now, yeah, it was just an amazing concert.
You forget
yeah,
how many
exactly.
songs they had.
There's not a dud. Yeah. You know, they can
and
go for days.
Are they really friends?
Yes, obviously. Honest to God, they've never had a fight. They've never had a falling out, because they just delineated things right from the beginning. Mm. You know, one wrote the songs, one sung them. They never had any fights about royalties and all that sort of thing, because they sorted it all out. So you can see them for yourselves when they kick off their Aussie tour next month in Canberra. All the dates are on our website. Don't miss it. Mm.